Welcome. Good to see you all tonight. Thanks for coming. My name is Jared. I'm the pastor here, one of the leaders of this church, Endeavor Communities. We're just really excited to have everybody here tonight and open up a really warm and friendly discussion about spirituality or the lack thereof. And we're just excited that you're here tonight. So I want to go ahead and welcome up Bernie.
Thank you, Pastor. Welcome, everybody. We'd like to thank Endeavor Church for hosting this. It's very valuable. Tonight we're going to talk about hope, and we have two guest speakers here. One's an expert on Christianity. He's a professor and a pastor, Ray Lubeck. And Sylvia Benner is a representative of CFI-Portland. And one thing I want to caution everybody, I know people have strongly held beliefs. Sometimes they get really emotional when they hear things they don't agree with. So if you feel your blood start to boil, feel free to take a break, take a walk outside, or go to the bathroom, or something like that. Yeah. Nobody will know the real reason why you're leaving. That's okay. Just take a break. It's nothing abnormal. It's actually perfectly normal because we're talking about sensitive things here, about your innermost beliefs. And this is the reason why we're doing this, is because a lot of times people demonize each other. They say those people are stupid. No, those people are stupid. So let's get together and talk and try to be respectful and share ideas. So with that, we'll start. And here's the outline. We're going to start with Sylvia. She's going to have 10 minutes to talk from a atheistic worldview or atheistic viewpoint. Ray's going to talk for 10 minutes from a Christian viewpoint on this topic called The Content of Our Hope. And then I'm going to ask a question of each, and I'm going to do my best to try to probe them on what they said, to try to find a weak point to exploit. And then Dr. Ray Lubeck here will have a chance to cross-examine Sylvia, and then Sylvia will cross-examine Ray. And so all that right there happens in about the first half hour. So we're going to have almost an hour of Q&A time with the audience, and so you can share your ideas and get their take on it. So with that, we'll start. We're going to start with Sylvia. And so she's going to have 10 minutes. And feel free to take an extra minute to begin with to tell people about your community and what kind of events and things like that.
Okay. Can you hear me? This mic working? Okay. So my name is Sylvia Benner. I'm from Center for Inquiry. We are an organization that has nationwide branches. And our mission is to foster a secular society based on science, reason, free inquiry, and humanist values. And we have lectures, discussion groups, film nights, family programs, potlucks, and various other educational programs. So you can find us on Meetup, meetup.com. If you put in CFI, you will see the various groups in the area come up. Or you can go to our website at centerforinquiry.net, and you can find Portland, the Portland group on there. So the first thing I need to say is that I won't be speaking from an atheistic viewpoint. I will be speaking from a humanistic viewpoint. And the reason that is so is because atheism says absolutely nothing about content of hope or any worldview. Atheism is like not collecting stamps or not skiing. It doesn't tell you anything about what you might be doing. But not skiing is not a hobby, and atheism is not a faith. So after clarifying that, let's launch right in. So I like to apply, and I think this is something that Ray and I agree on, I like to apply the concept of a narrative. We have discussed this before, and I think narrative is a key concept. And I want to be clear that when I use the word narrative here in this presentation, I'm not talking about a made-up story or a fairy tale. When I look into the history books, they tell a narrative. And this narrative is based on information that we have. It's based on documentation. So there are true stories and there are made-up stories. And so when I'm talking about the humanist narrative, I'm not saying the story that humanists make up, but the story that humanists tell about humanity based on past evidence. And then there is a part of our story that is made up, which is the future, which is aspirational. And we are very aware that we're not predicting the future, but that we're aspiring to certain goals. So I think that street gangs and religion and things like the Society for Creative Anachronism or the role-playing Harry Potter or Star Trek fans have something in common, is that they present a narrative that solves a human problem. By the way, the Society for Creative Anachronism, those are the people who play the medieval games. You know, they have clubs and they have kingdoms, and then on weekends they go to the park and battle with swords and, you know, all kinds of fun like that. These are things that solve a problem for humans. And I think one of the central problems for humans is that life is pretty banal. So for the most part, you have your routine, you do your things in life, and at some point you ask yourself, is this all there is? This is kind of flat, there's just not much there. And so when you begin to tell a story about what you're doing and what your role in the world is, it all of a sudden becomes much more exciting. You have something that you're going for. Now, there's nothing wrong with telling a story. I just think that it has to be a true story. It's much more useful if you live in a true narrative rather than a made-up narrative. And so this whole thing goes to the question of meaning. So in Star Trek, for example, I have an affinity. I don't want to knock any of this. I have an affinity for that whole medieval stuff and for the Harry Potter stuff and for the Star Trek stuff. And if I weren't so terribly concerned about my dignity, I might don some forehead ridges and go to a Star Trek convention as a Klingon.
You look good with pointed ears.
So I get it. I really, really get it. And so the story that religion tells from, you know, what I have seen in religion is religion gives you this thing where you're living in this epic battle between good and evil. And you are a soldier in the army of the Lord. I think that's more a kind of a, Pentecostal. I've heard that from the Pentecostal corner. And that is, you know, you're up to something important. Your existence isn't just I show up, I do what I do, you know, I pop out a few kids and then I die. It's you know, something useful. You know, you're doing something that actually makes a difference in the world. And I have a great deal of sympathy for that approach. Now, the thing about the difference religion is different from all the others is that the Harry Potter fans and the Star Trek fans and the people in the SCA, they know that their narrative is a fictional one. And the religious narrative is a fictional one, of course. And the religions don't know or don't acknowledge that their stories are fictional stories. And that's, you know, it becomes a problem. So the humanist narrative extends back into the past, and I'm going to spend a lot more time on the past than I'm going to spend on the future, because reality has a very high value in humanism, and goals have a high value too, but I need to demonstrate that the humanist approach is a real story. It's one where we have already won a lot of battles, a lot of progress has already been made. So the humanist narrative, I would describe it as a narrative of coming out of the darkness and fear and superstition into knowledge, reason, confidence in what humans can accomplish, and the whole thing results in an increase in well-being. Things have been getting better for millennia, they've been getting better for centuries, and they've been getting better for decades, and even year over year, they're getting better on average. There are bumps in the road, but overall, we have enough data to assert that the human condition has been improving. So I want to also make clear that this is the story of all humans, not just the story of secular people. Until very recently, saying you were a non-believer was a life-threatening statement to make. So we don't have a lot of records about who made, you know, all the difference, and certainly a lot of religious people have made a lot of difference because the majority of people on the planet are religious. What's relevant here is not that this was done by religious people or secular people. What's relevant is that it was done by human beings. And this is what we've done. And it's really quite remarkable. I'm not aware of any other species that has had this level of progress. Okay, so first I want to demonstrate that progress has been made. I'm going to rely heavily on some of the work of that's done by Steven Pinker. Steven Pinker wrote a book called The Better Angels of Our Nature, and if you want to have a quick 20-minute summary, you can go to TED. He did a 20-minute TED talk called The Myth of Violence, and he specifically discusses this part of human well-being that involves violence. So there's this mythology out there that we used to exist in some state of nature, that it was blissful and things have just been getting worse and worse because there was World War I and there was World War II and then there was, you know, the genocide in Rwanda and all these terrible things. But when you actually look at what we know from history, or when we don't have history from the, you know, from these very, very early peoples on the planet, but we see native populations that exist on the planet today, and we see that, for example, that they are in South America, they have statistics for South America, that the chance of a male dying at the hand of another male ranges from about 60% to about 10%. That's a really huge probability that you're going to die violently. Compare that to the US and Europe, where the probability ranges is about in the area of 2%. So Spinker asserts that we live in the most peaceful era in history ever. Interstate wars have declined. Deadly ethnic riots have declined. Military coups have declined. And worldwide, the most important thing, he says, is that there has been a huge incline in interstate wars. Let me see if this... I am now. Here we go. So this is not very, very clear. So you can see up here the very high likelihood of death and some of these other native populations. It goes down and down and down. And then the lowest one is actually the modern Western world that is the least violent on this scale. Now let's look at this next one here. This is a graph of the average number of battle deaths per state-based armed conflict. This is a chart between 1946 and 2007. And you can see, while there are bumps, you know, that go up and down, overall we have had a huge decline in the number of people who die in battle. Pinker says that there has been a huge decline in socially sanctioned forms of violence. In the Middle Ages, mutilation and torture were pretty routine, chopping off hands, cutting out tongues, blinding. These were the kinds of punishment meted out for fairly small things. Burning at the stake, disemboweling, breaking on the wheel. He says this is the kind of thing that today would get you a fine, not so in the Middle Ages. Cruelty as entertainment has declined. There was a lot of animal cruelty, just people just do for entertainment, the burning of cats, slow burning of cats. Some criminologists have assembled statistics on murder.
Sylvia, and 1 minute?
1 minute? I've got 9 minutes. Okay, let me click through here. Okay, so the point is, we have had technological progress, we've had economic progress, we've had great moral progress as a society. We have a demonstration that human well-being has increased a great deal. If you look at these lines, everything that's going up is what you want to go up, everything that's going down is what you want to go down. The humanist hope is a future in which we have handled problems of poverty, of violence, of hunger, of the diseases that we're currently battling, and where we have the kind of technological progress that'll take us into ever-increasing well-being. And as a humanist, you live in that kind of narrative where you, as a human being, as an individual, contribute to more reason, to more critical thinking, to more science, to better technological development, and to the general moral betterment of society. Wow, that went fast.
Okay.
I've never lost track of time this badly.
You're that
never.
Interesting.
There'll be plenty of time for the audience Q&A. Maybe you can slip in some of your material when you answer their question.
Oh, that's okay. Yes, we'll figure it out.
Okay, so now we're going to have Ray's response from a Christian perspective. And so Ray, you got 10 minutes, and feel free to take an extra minute to, you know, welcome people to, and tell them what you're doing for ministry and all that.
Okay. Well, my name is Ray Lubeck. I attend here at Endeavor. Very much excited about what is happening in our small body here as we reach out to the Rockwood community, which is in many ways, a very needy community. I'm also a professor at Multnomah University and an adjunct professor at Western Seminary, and there I get to teach primarily Bible class. No, I get to teach primarily students, which is a lot of fun, but in terms of the courses that I teach, philosophy and Bible study methods and a number of others. As far as our topic here, what's next, the content of our hope, I'll start off with a radio host by the name of Tom Bockett, who says, a person needs just three things to be truly happy in this world. Someone to love, something to do, and something to hope for. And it's as if he's looking at Maslow's hierarchy of needs and saying that hope belongs as one of those central defining things for human identity. I have a quote here from Bertrand Russell, a rather lengthy one, and he wrote this later in his life. Now, Bertrand Russell was initially exposed to religion as a young man, rejected that. He ended up writing a book at a time when there were many other books, Why I'm a Christian, Why I'm a Methodist, Why I'm a Presbyterian. He wrote a book called Why I Am Not a Christian. Here's what he says toward the end of his life. Man's origin, his growth, his hopes, which is our topic, and fears, his loves and his beliefs are but the outcome of accidental collocations of atoms. No fire, no heroism, no intensity of thought and feeling can preserve an individual life beyond the grave. All the labors of the ages, all the devotion, all the inspiration, all the noonday brightness of human genius are destined to extinction in the vast death of the solar system. And the whole temple of man's achievement must inevitably be buried beneath the debris of a universe in ruins. No philosophy which rejects them can hope to stand. Only within the firm foundation of unyielding despair can the soul's salvation henceforth be safely built. All right. So actually, what I'm struck with is quotations from other atheists that point in this direction that give me just deep concern, really, for the well-being of atheists. Now, Sylvia rightly pointed out that there's atheists and there's atheists. In my philosophy classes, I refer to them as happy-faced and frowny-faced atheists, and they are as different as Lutherans and Catholics. Okay? Another quote here from an atheist. Life's so fragile, a successful virus clinging to a speck of mud, suspended in endless nothing. Well, here are some who have thought through their atheism to the point of the nihilism that it seems to be directing us. A couple of quotes here. This is from bumper stickers from FFTF, Freedom From Religion Foundation, atheistic organization. First one says, we put our faith in science. And what I find interesting there is at least they acknowledge the role of faith. In one of our previous conversations, I was kind of pressing Sylvia on this point, and while she didn't admit to having faith, she did admit to having belief. So a second bumper sticker from the same organization, I have faith in myself, not in a God. And I guess all I want to do at this point is to say everybody has faith. It really now is a matter of the contrast between what it is we're putting our faith in. But the one that was most interesting to me was this third one, because it's by one of the co-presidents of the Freedom From Religion Foundation, who says, I just lost faith in faith. And my heart really breaks for someone who would actually go on record saying, I've lost faith in it. So, quick contrast between what I see in these two world stories. What will happen in the future? Christian theism versus atheism. What will happen to your body in the future, say 50, 100 years from now? For the Christian, resurrection. For the atheist, decomposition. What will happen to your spirit? For the Christian, eternal life. For atheism, the question doesn't even register because spirit is not on the radar. What will happen to our species, Homo sapiens? Well, in Christian theism, it endures, like forever. What happens in secular humanism? Our species will be eclipsed. There are those secular scientists who are projecting that as early as 2050, we may have a species superior to Homo sapiens. It's only a matter of time, though. We will be eclipsed and then eventually extinct, sooner or later. What will happen to the universe? new heavens and new earth versus heat, death, in one way or another. So, how about Christians? What is the content of our hope? And here I'm trying to make this very even-handed, so I'm not trying to privilege one particular Christian denomination or their view of the future. This is what pretty much all Christians would acknowledge. First of all, Jesus is coming back. We wait for this blessed hope. Secondly, a resurrection and we get new bodies. And after my most recent surgery, it becomes more and more appealing every time I think about this. Several different biblical passages that indicate this. A third thing that we have to hope for is vindication. That is, some of the injustice, the gross injustice that is happening now, will eventually be righted. A new heavens and a new earth, which has to do with the planet rather than simply a heat death. And actually, biblically speaking, there's two things that need to be balanced here. One of them is salvation of the entire cosmos, which I think unfortunately has been underplayed, as well as salvation of individual souls. And as Christians, I think we probably need to critique ourselves for putting too much emphasis on just salvation of my own soul and not what God has in mind for the rest of the universe. A fifth thing is no more pain, no more evil. And a final thing is being together with God, which I think will be the greatest thing of all. Hope is Christian hope. As long as a dynamic tension exists between the present enjoyment of the benefits of God and the yearning for the fullness of our redemption. In other words, there should be, in the present, a kind of disquiet among all Christians because the world is not as it should be. But there's an aspiration, both in the here and now in this life, and also in the future, for it getting better. Now, it seems to me that atheism has a couple of areas that it kind of struggles with. One of them is what I will call the more modernistic approach, which builds its hopes on a number of experiments which haven't worked. Various projects for a utopia independently of God. Marx had that ideal. Hitler's fascism was that ideal. And one could even say that American democratic idealism could also fit into the same category. Is it really working? Are we at utopia yet? All right. So we have modernism. And then we have postmodernism, which is hopelessness. Prepare to be crushed. All right? So I have just that one quote, and I can multiply this many, many, many times over. But postmoderns say things like what Kurt Vonnegut says here, mud. We living creatures are the mud that gets to sit up and look around at all the other mud. Then we lay back down again. Right. And that is the frowny-faced version of the more postmodern atheist. And, of course, I recognize that Sylvia does not fall into this category. But what I would like to propose is that for those who are smiley-faced atheists, it's easier when you're a little bit younger and the more life proceeds, the more historically smiley-faced atheists have converted to frowny-faced atheists. So that's all I have.
Okay, you got another minute, you sure?
I'm fine. Okay. I'll give her a minute back, because I want to see the rest of her slides.
Oh, there were only four slides, so I only had a few slides. Okay. So,
we're going on to the next one. Did you want to really give her your time? Give her a minute?
Sure,
okay,
I'll find
that. No, I don't have any more to add. This is going to just discombobulate my presentation.
Okay. We're going to move on to the next segment then. This is where I'm going to ask a question of each, and a lot of this comes, I think, from Ray's presentation. So first I'm going to ask Sylvia a question. Mm-hmm. Okay, so if you look at the grand scheme of things from a big perspective, let's say a billion years from now or a trillion years from now, everything's gone, everything's erased, eventually the whole universe is going to go to heat death, as Ray said. Mm-hmm. That's only a trillion years. There's still another trillion up to the exponent of a trillion years. I mean, eternity goes for a long time if time goes on. So how is that not, how do you deal with that? Because I think a lot of people suffer depression too, so they might say, like, what's the point? In other words, there's a saying that it's like rearranging chairs on the Titanic, it's sinking, so why, you know, why bother, why hope for anything if everything's going to get erased?
Well, okay, sorry. Okay. To some extent, that question really makes very little sense to me. I have had depression, real depression. It was, you know, postpartum, it was this hormonal depression. So I have some experience with that. And nothing I have ever learned about the universe has reinforced that. As a matter of fact, during that time when I couldn't get interested in anything, what I used for therapy is I would pull up Michio Kaku, or I would take The Elegant Universe from Brian Greene, and I would sit there and I would read about string theory, about the future of the universe. And it's the one thing that got me inspired and pulled out. I think this obsession with eternity is something that is kind of a cognitive virus that has been implanted. I don't know the exact quote, but Mark Twain said something like once, you know, well, you know, when I was dead for millions of years before I was born, and I never suffered the slightest inconvenience from it. The fact that I am, and this is what Vonnegut's really talking about. It's not, oh, we're mud, we're going to go back to mud. That's not a negative statement. That was like, we are, as Richard, and I'm amazed you don't quote Richard Dawkins or Lawrence Krauss or all the others who are, you know, smiley-faced atheists, right, yeah, of advanced age, in Richard Dawkins' case, who is, you know, we are the fortunate ones. We are the ones who have that brief moment of consciousness among all the human beings that would have been possible. We are the ones who are here, who can experience ourselves. I think that's fantastic.
Okay, so let me ask a question a little different way. Mm-hmm. Let's say, for example, some atheist says, you know, I'm really motivated to try to deconvert the world because the world would be such a better place. Well, if you look at it from a perspective from a trillion years from now, mm-hmm, if everybody became a Christian today or everybody became an atheist, mm-hmm, well, it doesn't matter because everything gets erased. So mm-hmm, how could an atheist say, I have a goal and a dream to see something when it's all going to get erased anyway?
It matters to the young child who's not going to have her clitoris cut off. It matters to the woman who doesn't have to be covered in a burqa. It matters to the woman who gets to make a choice about whether or not she's going to be a parent.
So in the temporal,
it matters to the man, yeah, who is sent to war, to some holy war. It matters.
Okay, so everybody understands in the temporal realm, mm-hmm, it matters.
Right.
But from the big scale, when you zoom out, it doesn't matter because they're all dead.
What a strange criterion. Why is it a requirement that something last forever for it to be good or worthy of pursuit? I think that's a completely artificial standard.
Well, I guess the example is, let's say, for example, you work for General Motors, and I say, I want you to design a brand new car, and as soon as you're done with it and designing it, mm-hmm, you can drive it for one day, and I say, okay, I'm going to take it to the junkyard. And you might think, well, geez, I worked, it'd be nice if this thing, you know, hung around for a little bit. Mm-hmm. How can I get motivated to build a car when I know, you know, after the first day they're going to throw it in the junkyard?
Everybody builds cars and knows they're not going to be around 20 years from now. They're not going to be built 20 years from now. They're still motivated to build the car. And, you know, whatever we achieve in terms of human well-being is going to be around, not just for 20 years, but for decades, for centuries, for millennia maybe.
Okay, so now I'll go on to Ray. Kind of the same question. The way you introduced it, yeah, it's really sad to be an atheist because, you know, everything might get erased and what's the point of living and everything. But if this is all about truth, if it's all about truth, let's say it was true, there is no God, and these are the real ramifications of it, would you rather deal with the truth or would you stay with something you know not to be true because it makes you feel good? In other words, emotions don't determine truth. So is it about truth or is it about just feeling good?
Oh, I would absolutely say that this has to do with truth. Paul himself writes in 1 Corinthians that if the resurrection is not a reality, then we're fools. We're to be pitied. So I take it very seriously that we're in pursuit of truth.
So I think a major point in your presentation was, look how depressing this is from the atheist standpoint, but none of that even matters. If it's true, then you need to accept it. So the whole point about it being depressing is really irrelevant.
No, what I'm trying to do is simply to say, best of all worlds, what can this world story provide for you? And now, what is the best of all worlds? If this one is true, what could it offer? And I think if you simply look at those and say, we're doing our best from both sides to try and pursue truth, but one of them seems to offer a lot more in the way of substance for hope.
One of them offers a lot more emotional satisfaction and emotional security and feelings.
But what is your basis for making that statement? Why do you say that this is emotional rather than a happy faith atheist?
So as a Christian, you think you're going to live forever. You're never going to die, so you don't have to deal with your survival instinct. So basically, I don't have to worry about death because I'm going to live forever. So that feels really good compared to the atheist who says, I have to come to grips with my own mortality. I have to deal with this.
I think that coming to grips with one's own mortality is not something that is unique to atheists by any means.
Well, you're not really going to die if you're a Christian. You're going to live forever.
Yes, and if that's true, then by all means, I've got all sorts of room for hope. But basically, if I'm hearing your premise right, if you're wrong, then what are you going to do then? And what I'm trying to go back to is your premise and question that. Suppose I'm right, or suppose we just toss it up and make it even. What is the best that each of the world stories can offer?
Okay. The point I'm trying to make is, I think the discussion is all about the truth. I think we all agree that we want to follow the truth. That's the most important thing. And I think a lot of your presentation had to do with, look how emotionally satisfying this is with this worldview. And so I'm trying to say, emotionally satisfying in no way determines truth. So it's really irrelevant. Because if you did come to see there was no God, then you wouldn't give this presentation. Then you'd probably say, look, people, we need to deal with this, even though it's depressing.
My response to you would be, I think that that's a knife that cuts both ways. Because if it turns out that the postmodern, that some of the more seasoned atheists, that the frowny face are right, then the wish projections of the smiley face atheists are just as doomed.
Okay. So,
which would be your own category.
Okay, so we'll move on. I'm going to give the audience a chance to. But now we get to an interesting place where you guys get to question each other. Maybe I sparked something here too. So we'll start with Ray. You can ask Sylvia questions for 5 minutes. And the way I like to do this is you're in the driver's seat. So I'd like it to where you can ask her a question. And instead of, you know, responding back in a lecture or a sermon, I'd like Ray to be in the driver's seat, you know, like be able to interrupt and say, that's not what I mean or whatever, and try to get some direct answers from Sylvia. And then when it turns the other way, Sylvia will be in the driver's seat and be able to make sure that the response is not a sermon, but a conversation and trying to really get to this, what this person is trying to ask. So Ray, you can start with 5 minutes.
First of all, I think that I'd like to just acknowledge appreciation once again for being a dialogue partner. And rather than seeing you as an adversary, I see you much more as someone willing to engage in conversation. And I also really want to affirm a number of the things that I did hear you mention, and some with more emotion and passion. That is some of the things that you find most deeply disturbing about some of the things that have happened in history are ones that I would share very much. And my heart breaks for those very same scenarios that you've described. Along with that, where we as humans have not lived up to our ideals in the past, various atrocities, hunger, mistreatment of people, rightly understood Christian theism, I think, lines up with all the objections.
You have to give a question for Sylvia.
Yes, I'm working my way into that, but I want to affirm a number of things I think that we can share. Probably the biggest difference that I can see, though, is this slide from what I see as the smiley face into the frowny face. And I'm certain that you are aware of writings of many scholars who have made that move beyond from the more optimistic versions of atheism to the more pessimistic versions. What keeps you going on the more optimistic plane rather than kind of slipping into the direction of a Heidegger, of a Nietzsche, of a Camus, of a Sartre, or different ones like that who have also started off with much more optimism and then deconverted themselves?
So first I'd like to say that these people are in the minority. I hang out with a lot of atheists all the time. And So these people are in the minority. I think what we have here is a phenomenon of people being the early adopters, or the early admitters, I should say, the people who early on admitted that they were atheists. It's a tough row to hoe. It's like being among the early people who come out as homosexuals. They, you know, and then there's this thing that homosexuality is like causes mental illness and that kind of stuff. No. Being socially disconnected, being ostracized causes mental illness. And I can imagine it was similar for these atheists. Most of the atheists I know are very, you know, engaged people, very passionate people. So what keeps me going? First of all, I don't see the end of my existence as a negative. And I don't know how else to describe it. I don't have a fear of death. And nor did I have a fear of death when I was depressed, by the way. This notion of non, I have a regret that my life won't go on forever, because there's so many things I want. I know that 80, 90 years, 120 years won't be enough to get it all done. But there are many things I have regrets over, you know, choices in the past, things I've said to my son, you know, dumb stuff I've done. But none of it induces despair. And meanwhile, I have this life, and I am among this. I have this incredible privilege of being here. The fact that I can talk to you is anything but banal. I have consciousness. When I get present to that, it's just I'm awed. It just astonishes me, and maybe I don't understand this emotional reality that people get into. I think it's a learned despair, quite frankly. I don't see it as a huge cost.
Got another minute? You want to ask her something?
In the case of some of the people that I just mentioned, they saw the atrocities of the Europe in the middle of the 20th century, and I'm sure that that played into it. However,
they didn't have Pinker's data.
Yeah, very, very. What they had was data from the world all around them, which was a couple of back-to-back world wars and subsequent things that have happened. At a more personal level, though, and at a more street level, I would propose, though, that there's a much higher percentage than certainly the ones that would be involved, for instance, in this kind of an organization. Those who are writing music, poetry, online kinds of things, there's a myriad of websites that would represent at least many hundreds of thousands, if not millions, who would fall in the more frowny face category. So that is a reality, I would say.
Okay, so now, Sylvia, you have 5 minutes to ask Ray, and remember you're in the driver's seat, so feel free to interrupt him if you think he's going off the wrong road.
So I'm going to package two. You've asked my first question, so we'll be done with that. I'm going to package the other two questions in one because they are related. So this is what it looks like to me as a former Christian, having experienced this incredible sense of the moment I decided I didn't believe it anymore. This incredible sense of freedom. I was too excited to sleep at that point. So being a Christian, you have maybe, I'll give you the hope. I say, okay, this is all nice and fine, but the hope comes with a terrible, terrible price. It comes with the fear that you might not make the cut. And there's this incredible possibility of hell that is, you know, that people, many people believe in literally. And it comes packaged with something that is maybe not quite as bad, but pretty bad still. There is this person, this entity, who knows your thoughts. This reminds me of George Orwell's 1984. The unrelenting monitoring. And if you have, I think Kitchens points this out, if you have a Hitler or you have a North Korea, you can escape this by... with death. You can't even escape this during death. You are a slave forever.
Are you working into a question?
Yes. Doesn't that trouble you? Doesn't that get heavy? Doesn't that, how do you deal with that burden of having no freedom to yourself? You're owned.
Yes. I would say it would be the terror of light. That is, light exposes. And God... Christ says, I am the light of the world. And one of the things that light does is exposes truth, right? And so I don't have to fear anything stumbling out of a skeleton in my closet, such that God would recoil and say, "Oh, myself," like that one. I never thought of that before. "Oh, myself, I can't believe that person did that, and now cease to love me." There's no surprises. So to be completely known and yet still loved, that to me is what intimacy is all about. I would welcome that kind of exposure.
Hmm. Okay. And you don't ever feel like you need distance and space and ownership of yourself. You don't have that desire.
Oh, I have many, many times tried ownership of myself, and I'm not a very good driver when it comes to steering my own life. And so I need that transcendent guidance, that light, to help me from myself.
Mm-hmm. How much time?
Two more minutes.
Two more minutes? Okay. You referred to experiments that have not worked. Now, these experiments, of course, have, I'm assuming you mean like communes and things like that, and these attempts at utopias.
Right, yeah.
Of course, these have been very small scale. There have been attempts at theistic societies. There are many around us now in the Middle East. North Korea is pretty much a religious state, with the God being the head of the state. What about the real-life experiments in theistic governments, such as medieval Europe? Those experiments have not worked.
Yeah.
What do you say about that?
I would say I agree with you completely. And where we have seen Christians who have been put into positions of unchecked power, turns out they're no different. They kind of devolve into their baser, more selfish their identities, and so I'd be deeply disturbed by all of those. Am I in any way affirming what I see in medieval Europe? No, I see a lot of ill that came out, and when it seems to me whenever the church tries to engage society through a position of power, that we have done a very, very poor job. But that's not the model that Jesus gave us. Jesus gave us a model of washing other people's feet.
Mm-hmm. So you reject attempts to put things like Ten Commandments in courthouses and to pass laws that are anti-gay laws that are based on scripture.
I don't think
like
that you're going to change the human heart by passing laws. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you reject those notions.
I reject those notions. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, that's about time. Mm-hmm. So we have about 40 minutes or so till 8 o'clock. Raise your hand if you have a question, and I want you to try to stay on topic as much as possible. Our topic is about hope, the content of our hope. So try to keep it to that. If we exhaust the subject, then we can branch off the other thing. So please try to keep it to that. And also try to keep your questions short. And just to let you know too, I like to give preference to kids, you know, high school and college and even younger elementary school kids too, just to give learning opportunity for them. So I may switch to some of them often. So if you have a question, you can raise your hand. There's a lot of people with questions, so don't feel bad if you don't have to get feel like that. So we'll start over here. Can you step up over here?
This question is mostly for Sylvia, but Ray, I'd like to hear your answer as well. Okay. At the beginning, you mentioned it's most helpful for us to live in a narrative, and from what I know about you, Ray, you would agree with that statement. And you mentioned that no other species, you know, progress to that kind of thinking. Why is it, do you think, that we need that narrative? Why is it that when we don't have some type of narrative, life is, I think you used the word banal, mm-hmm. or meaningless, or mm-hmm. just kind of boring? Why is that specific to us as humans? Why do you think that we need that?
I'm not sure that I said we need it. I think there are some people who tolerate that quite well. I think that I said I'm sympathetic to that need. I think that's what I said. I think for most humans it is useful. So to that extent, your interpretation is correct. I don't really want to hazard a guess. I think we have an ability to think symbolically that exceeds that from what we know. And who knows the mind of a dolphin or a chimpanzee? But from what we know, we are the only species who can think symbolically and who may be able to contemplate its own death. But you know what I see is that we are a social species. And our particular adaptation seems to be to accumulate knowledge that we can pass on and to improve things. That seems to be one of our adaptations, is how we survive as a species. So it stands to reason that we would create a context in which to do that. Like, you need to come up with a reason, in a sense. That's the best guess, but I am not, I don't know that there's any science on this. I don't know that anybody, and there are many people who can make better guesses than I'm sure. So I don't have the expertise to answer the question, and that would be my wild speculation.
Do you have a brief comment, Ray?
Yeah, maybe just a quick one. I believe it was Walter Fisher, a professor of communication at University of South Carolina, who suggested that maybe our species, rather than being referred to as Homo sapiens, those who are wise, that perhaps Homo narratans would be a more apt description. That is, we are that species that tells stories. And I find that a very intriguing notion. And I also wonder how in the world that fits into Darwinism.
You have to be pretty wise to tell a good story, though. Otherwise, it's not very good to read or very interesting.
I have a question for both of the people. If I'm a member of a church down the street that says that I don't have to die and be resurrected, if I can simply live forever in this body, and I'm getting younger all the time because I'm actually 106, and it offers so much more than in hope than either one of you, would you each join my church? And if not, why not?
You should take the first one.
Okay. I'll take the first one. And I would say, no, I would not attend that church. I have a very high regard for the Bible. And it seems to me that churches ought to be based on the truth that the Bible teaches, and the Bible doesn't teach anything like that at all. So I'm unapologetic in saying the Bible is a standard for my truth. It's not the only one, but it is an important one.
So you're saying it's not just your emotion, because the question is going right to, you know, if you get the greatest emotion and feeling, so you're not going to go for it because you don't think it's truthful.
Right.
Okay, well, these claims are actually among the few religious claims that can actually be directly disproven. So my standard of truth, of course, is not the Bible. It's experiment and evidence, and it would be very, I mean, this is not a surprising answer from an atheist. No, I would not join your church. I don't believe your claims. If you could prove those claims, now we're talking. Now, but until that, no.
Okay. Okay. I think this is more for Ms. Benner.
Mm-hmm.
If Christianism was true, Christianity. Sorry,
yeah.
Anyone that's a non-believer would lose everything. Wouldn't mm-hmm. get anything in the end. But if atheism was true, what would a Christian lose?
That sounds like you're talking about Pascal's wager. Do you know that term? Okay.
Well, there's actually a missionary too once. Uh-huh. He said, he is no fool who gives what he cannot keep to gain what he cannot lose.
Jim Elliot.
Okay.
So basically, yeah, so I'm trying to rephrase that.
So in other words, what have you got to lose by believing? You have a lot to lose by not believing, but you don't have much to lose by believing, right? Is that what you're saying? Kind of? Okay. Well, first of all, it would have to be a pretty stupid and on top of it a pretty shallow God who would take my lie and accept my pretense of belief, because I don't think belief is a matter of choice. You either believe something or you don't. And you can pretend to believe something if you don't believe it, but I don't think you can actually make yourself believe something. I don't see that. And then there seems, yeah, that's pretty much the
question meaningful. Might have been more too, if you're a Christian, what do you have to lose if atheism is true? Because
you mean in this life?
This, yeah, because this is the only life there is. And
oh.
So if you're
oh,
a Christian,
I see. Okay.
And you live for that, what's the loss, what's the harm?
Okay.
Remember?
basically, what I would say to that is, number one, there are a number of restrictions that Christians are supposed to live by. They don't always. And if you can manage to, the cognitive dissonance and be a hypocrite and enjoy all the things in life that we atheists think are completely unobjectionable, but that Christians deny themselves, then, you know, maybe it doesn't cost you anything to believe. But if you're actually authentic in your belief, I think there's a great cost in terms of the behaviors that you're restricted from. It gets really, really costly when you happen to be gay, for example. It becomes really costly when you happen to be in a bad marriage. It becomes extremely costly. The other thing is that truth matters. I think truth matters. And so the question is, if it made me feel really uncomfortable to not believe, which it didn't, and it made me feel really comfortable to believe, but the non-belief that there is not truly any God, what would I choose? I would prefer to be unhappy and have the truth than to be happy with a lie. There's something about freedom and about integrity that contributes to my well-being, my psychological well-being, more than emotional comfort, if that makes any sense.
Ray, what do you think about the questions? If you're a Christian and you live your Christianity, but it turns out atheism is true, do you think you lose anything living a Christian life?
Yeah, in fact, let me speak to both sides of that just a little bit. If atheism is true, then what have I missed out on? I've missed out on autonomy. I've missed out on indulging myself without guilt. I think that's ameliorated by the fact that when I've tried that self-indulgence, often, even aside from the guilt, there's been some pretty negative consequences on my own life as well. But one other weakness to Pascal's wager there is that it's a much more powerful argument when there's only one God that is the alternative. But probably the biggest weakness of Pascal's wager is that it could be postulated the same way for Allah. It was during a different time period where they could get away with that a little bit more easily.
Okay, any other questions?
This one goes more so to Ray. It's okay. More of a comment than it is a question. In your presentation, you said that both non-believers and believers have faith.
Yeah.
And I kind of wanted to call you on that a little bit. I think that you're misusing faith and trust. Because one of your examples was faith in science. While I wouldn't say I have faith in science and the belief that, okay, I just follow faith blindly, I have a tentative trust that can be given and can also be taken away. Like, it's similar to if I go to a mechanic. If I'm going to the mechanic, I don't have faith that the mechanic's going to repair my car. I have a good idea that he knows what he's talking about. But once you start saying, okay, the reason your engine's not working is because you have pixies in it, that's messing up all these pistons here. Okay, I'm probably going to go to a different mechanic.
Yeah.
I just
kind of
wanted to hear what you
had
to say
about that. Well, it was Socrates who said, I can win any argument in which I get to define the terms.
Yeah.
So it all has to do with how you define faith. And I would say that if by faith you mean taking irrational or an anti-rational blind leap towards something that I wish, then yeah, that would be very risky. But that's not how I understand faith. And for me, biblically speaking, they're the same term. Whether we're talking about Hebrew language or Greek language, faith is trust, trust is faith. And if we try to divorce it from that which has evidence, then we're all to be pitied.
Yeah, I could not agree more with the commenter, of course. There's a distinction between faith and belief. There are many things that I believe. I try not to believe things that I don't have good reasons to believe. And that act of trying not to believe things that I don't have good reason to believe means that I don't have faith. I actually disliked very much when I saw these FFRF stickers, and they were actually also billboards. I disliked the language very much. I thought it was very sloppy language. And I also disagree that you can win any argument where you get to define the terms. As long as the terms are correctly defined and you don't equivocate, you stick with the same definition, then you can have a real argument about things.
Okay.
I agree with your point that faith is not something that you just need to be willing to believe. But I have a question regarding your question with the topic of hope. It seems like both of you are kind of offering kind of a dismal hope.
What? Dismal?
A dismal hope. One is offering eternal hell or eternal heaven. Mm-hmm. So it's a choice. You can either go into one of those two, but wherever you go, you're eternally there. And eternal is not entirely very pleasing. If you are eternally in heaven and you're playing a harp forever, I'm not sure I'm going to be very happy. If I'm going to be in eternal hell, that's even worse. My point is this. If water evaporates from the oceans, it doesn't eternally remain as clouds. You know, it has to come down eventually.
Yeah.
No. So I'm not trying to say that, you know, resurrection is probably true. What I'm trying to say is, you know, why are you both offering only one eternal end? Why can't it be a progressive thing?
What do you mean by progressive?
Something that humanity is probably constructing over a period of time, rather than as, oh, this is the eternal end of humanity, or this is going to be the end of everything. You know, when Jesus comes back, it's going to be a rapture. All those people who believe will be going into the kingdom of God. Others born. Well, why is that? I mean, why can't there be?
Do you also mean progressive in the sense of reincarnation, where you're getting better and better?
No, not necessarily. I'm talking about progressive in terms of human beings creating a better opportunity for themselves every day, scientifically improving themselves, technologically and things like that. Why is that not a possible hope? Why is that not generally a possible hope? Instead, you know, even atheist side of the argument would say, you know, no matter how much you do this, all that is ultimately going to extinction.
Say that, by the way. That was his point.
I agree. I mean, you didn't say that. When I say it's the atheistic point of view, it's the atheistic point of view. You presented the humanistic point of view. So to be right, you did not say that at all. But you're saying, you know, atheists would say that, and you're right. But both Christians and atheists basically offer that. Why?
Okay.
You're not offering anything different from the atheists. That's what I'm trying to say.
I don't know where you derived your ideas of what heaven is like. You don't read anything about harps, halos, certainly there's praise of God. But the idea of progress, I don't find as being natively hostile to our idea of the future. That is it possible that we might progress while in heaven? I think it's a very real possibility, rather than an eternal stasis where you're always the same. Okay, what are we going to do today? Rather than it always being the same, I think that maybe we'll have the opportunity to fulfill what's called cultural mandate, that is to continue to use our faculties while in heaven, but to do so in a way that will always contribute toward good and positive. And I hope that we can do all kinds of different things and maybe explore many different possibilities. I envision, also not directly taught in the Bible, but after his resurrection, Jesus went on a long walk with a couple of people who were trying to understand his death and process all of that. He went on a walk with them to Emmaus, and there he explained to them the scriptures, and as I understand it, they must have been slapping their foreheads the whole time. Oh, that's what I meant. Well, I envision heaven spending maybe a couple of million years slapping our foreheads, doing the same thing, just having one big Bible study with a pretty good teacher. That, to me, is not just eternally always being the same. Far from it.
Pastor, what if a person lived a zillion years up to the gazillion power, just still a drop in the bucket to eternity, and they say, this is, you know what, I'm just tired of it. I mean, I've already seen and done everything. I've had enough. And I'm ready to go out. And they say, sorry, you can't go out. You have eternal life. You're forbidden to go out. And you're like, oh, I'm stuck here.
All I know is from what I can see from Scripture, it says that our eyes haven't seen, nor can our minds even comprehend the thing that God has in mind for us. And if that's the case, then I think it's going to be a lot more than just an amusement park.
Sylvia, do you have a comment?
I don't quite get how the question pertains to the points that I made. So I guess I can only agree. I mean, that's what I presented, is humanity as a progressive enterprise, and yeah.
I guess we need a third person up here to say how these other two are depressing outlooks, and here's my better one. That's what we're missing tonight, I guess. So we'll have to talk more afterwards, I guess. Okay, here's a question, and here's one here.
This question primarily for Professor Lubeck. There are many, I think you sort of alluded to it, with saying some atheists think that our species will be replaced by another in 2050, mm-hmm. but many futurists or people alive today think that technology will accelerate fast enough so that people, you know, alive with these young people, maybe the next generation, will be able to live for thousands and millions of years.
Right.
What do you think Christianity offers in hope, you know, in a time, say, if that comes to pass, what do you see of the advantages of Christian hope versus a hope in which, you know, humanists say, okay, we have eternal life now, what do you have to offer?
Yeah, I mean, rephrasing too is that, you know, for Christians, Jesus hopefully will come back today or tomorrow or next week or next year, but humanists might say we can live on this earth for millions of years if we take care of it. That's not what you're saying too?
Lots of talk about individual immortality through technology and also immortality for the species.
Regardless of whatever other kind of special things might happen, whether through deliberate genetic manipulation, or whether it's through bionics, or whether it's through medical enhancements of some sort, the Bible at least makes it clear that there is a special place for human beings. And are there superior beings that could emerge higher than human beings? There are right now. They're invisible, but Christianity also certainly holds to higher, smarter beings than us right now, but we're still given a special place.
I'm glad you brought up this business of technology and maybe transhumanism. I don't know if you refer to transhumanism precisely, mm-hmm. but I'm glad you brought that up because it's something that I didn't get to in my presentation. The possibilities that human beings offer other human beings are just staggering when you look into what we have achieved so far and what is now plausible. I mean, there are now plausible avenues to extending lifespans long enough until the next technology comes around to extend lifespans yet longer and longer. And that is just mind-boggling. And I am so preoccupied with the possibilities that humans create for humans. I don't dwell much in unsupported scare scenarios, and you know, I think there's so much to relish. That's just astonishing.
Okay, another question.
This is for him. do you want to be in heaven forever, like for gazillions and gazillions of years?
Yep.
Sylvia, I wanted you to clarify your talk about how how life for humans have improved, and you framed it within the context of Western civilization from pagan antiquity, where mm-hmm. the chances of us dying were very high, all the way till contemporary society, where the percentage was very low. But by doing that, aren't you ignoring everything that happened in the 20th century?
No, this data includes World War I, World War II, all our various genocides. These data that I showed include those. And that's what's so astonishing, because you know, we look at these things, and what is at work then? It's the availability heuristic, which is when we can recall something easily, we assign it a higher probability. So it looks to us like these violent deaths are increasing, but that's not the case. We just know about them more than we used to. So this data is included.
Okay, and do you feel like human life is better or more safe for some people by virtue of not our moment in history, but rather by social and physical location?
Are you saying about the difference in safety between me here in the United States and, say, Sam Harris's refugee in Somalia?
Yes.
That? Okay. I can't quantify that. It's certain that there is more safety and security here. It has to do with government. It has to do with standards of ethics. One of the things that we see is that the countries in which human security is very low tend to be countries that are pretty dominated by religion. I'm sure there are exceptions, but on average, this relationship holds true. So I'm not trying to say by any means that there's nothing to fix, that everything's honky-dory, that everybody is happy and safe. I'm not saying that. I'm saying that given how things are now, with all the stuff we still have to fix, they are a lot better than they used to be.
Okay. Dr. Lubeck, this is kind of a three-party question.
Oh, no. You might have to go back and repeat them one at a time, but I'll give it a try.
I'll try to ask them real briefly.
Yeah.
Do we have to believe in Christ to go to heaven? That's one part. How do we know that Christianity is the true faith as opposed to other religions in the world, such as Islam, Buddhism, Hinduism? And what happened to the victims of the Jewish genocide in World War II? Did they go to hell?
Okay. I'm going to make you ask them one at a time, so keep the microphone close there.
Yeah.
So if you could ask them in order, I'll answer them in order.
Must we believe in Christ to go to God?
If I were creating my own religion, I certainly wouldn't create that particular doctrine. On the other hand, I don't think that I can pick and choose my own doctrines on a matter of preference. After all, that would be way too emotional, Humperney. Rather, I want to go with truth. And if I do take the Bible as being truth, and there is an exclusivism that is built into that that I have to acknowledge. And there's a number of passages that would indicate, yes, someone has to acknowledge Jesus Christ specifically in order to go to be with him in fellowship for eternity.
So I don't know what the numbers are, the ratio, but it seems to me that there is a terrifically huge number of people who will not go to heaven.
I don't know any more about the numbers than you, but that could very well be the case. Now, again, if I were to do this on my preference or what I think is fair, then I probably wouldn't parse it out that way. On the other hand, I think that maybe there's a number of misconceptions about the nature of hell itself. I think it was Richard Niebuhr who said, it is unwise to speculate about either the furniture of heaven or the temperature of hell. And I don't think that hell is all about either flames or about other metaphors. I mean, we have metaphors that talk about fire, but we have metaphors that talk about darkness. Those are categorically exclusive of one another. I take them both to be metaphorical.
Jesus is the one who said, wide is the gate that leads to destruction and narrow is the one that leads to whatever.
Well,
so
where I was going with that is that
hell's not so bad.
What I'm saying is maybe hell is not this place as much as it is a condition that is already being experienced right now. In other words, what is hell? Ultimately, it's separation from God. For those who are atheists, there's no real change. There's a non-relationship there. The non-relationship will simply be confirmed.
So all the Jews that died in the Holocaust are saying you don't know that's God's choice of what happens to them? That's not your business or concern or knowledge?
Yeah, I think that it's dangerous when any one of us presume to draw the circle of those who are included or disincluded. I wouldn't want to draw it either larger than God or smaller than God. So I'm really reticent to say this person's in, that person's out. What I would say is those who do not have a relationship with him now will continue to not have a relationship with him then. That's all.
Is it okay for us to say we don't know?
Yeah. Although I don't know that any one of us would want to remain there forever. And on a practical basis, we're going to act one way or the other. The agnostic to me is simply one who will end up living out a particular story, whether or not they've even acknowledged it or feel very certain epistemologically about it.
Okay. Well, Sylvia, I had a question for you. Concerning your, and Dr. you can also maybe answer to this, concerning to hope and Christian philosophy, Christian beliefs, and how we think, and that is involving with the Ten Commandments, which you briefly touched on, and also principles of what Jesus Christ said in the Bible, of how we should treat others and how we should treat the world around us. How is that not an idea of hope of what we should be achieving, what we should be looking for, and how does that differ from humanism, and how is that difference? Well, is that not achieving a positive outlook of how we should take care of others and the world around us? Does that differ from your beliefs?
Well, I think the crucial issue isn't what does the Bible teach you about how to act toward others. There's the Old Testament and there's the New Testament, and they are very different in nature. You can work very hard to bring them together, but they don't match. They talk about an entirely different approach to treating others. I think the key question is this. Okay, let's say I have Dr. Peters here. I have a medical complaint, and I go see him. He has at his disposal knowledge and technology in the 20th century. None of this knowledge and technology is found in the Bible. It was found by research scientists. And the reason he can make a difference for me is because he has access to that knowledge. The Bible teaches nothing as useful as that. People prayed during the three plague pandemics. They had no streptomycin. Today we don't pray. Today we vaccinate those who are in danger of immediate contact, and we treat the plague hopefully early enough to make a difference. And I don't need to have the Bible or any other holy book to know that when someone is in distress, I need to help. Dogs know that. Rats know that. We know this from experiments. Human beings aren't the only ones who have morality, compassion, empathy. Other species have that too. It is an outcome of natural selection, of evolution. One of our adaptations is we are a social species. We contribute to each other's survival. That's what makes things work. And if you have the moral and social adaptations of a social species, and you combine that with religion, all you have is what the species has anyway, with some potential to do some really mean things to other people because of the religion. But if you leave the religion out of it, and you just take the compassion and empathy that is built into us as social mammals, and you combine that with evidence-based thinking and reason, you get things like streptomycin. That's really useful. Very useful, much more useful than prayer.
Okay, I'm not going to ask you both if you have a response. Let me know if you have a burning response. And don't forget, we're going to close with the minute summary also.
Ooh, I'm burning.
Okay.
I would say that Christians have every reason not to simply be pie in the sky, I can't wait to get up there, and meanwhile I'm just doing time down here on earth, but rather we should be very much engaged in social issues and medical issues, in scientific research, and all of those kinds of things. I think that what we've been commissioned to do is to present in the here and now what the kingdom of God will be like, and we can be sort of an appetizer. We're not going to ever be there. We're not going to be the full thing, but we ought to be very deeply engaged in research and to contributing in humanitarian ways. And I don't see that as being in any way competitive with the gospel. That's part of the gospel message itself.
Can I say one thing, just to clarify?
Yeah, briefly, yeah.
Okay. So I'm not saying that Christians can't or don't. What I'm saying is when you, as a Christian, do research to help those in distress and have better tools, the kind of thinking you're applying is not the kind of thinking that you're taught in the Bible. It's the kind of thinking that humanism teaches.
And a quick response to that would be many of those researchers, and I know some of them at the University of Washington Med School and things like that, who begin their research day in prayer.
It's fine. But then they stopped praying and started thinking. I'm not sure I'm getting your question. Can you rephrase it?
Yeah, you started talking about how when Christians, when they think they're going to go to heaven, and then there's this, oh, am I going to get to go? Am I going to get
that uncertainty, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and what's your understanding of the Christian belief on that subject, and if Ray would respond? Does that make sense?
I'm going to try and get my head around it. I mean, I can't, you know, do a whole dissertation on what Christians think about, you know, heaven versus hell, but roughly, there's this split between Catholicism and Protestantism about do you get there by deeds and do you get there by belonging to this body of believers, like the church as the vehicle to salvation, or is it about faith, kind of divorced from deeds? I don't find either doctrine very persuasive, needless to say. What are you trying to get at? Are you trying to get at why would I worry about going to hell? Are
you? Well, maybe I think what she's saying is some Christians believe that you shouldn't, I mean, if you're doubting it, maybe you're having a problem with bad theology. If you're really a believer and you understand the Bible, you shouldn't be doubting. Is that what Nikki?
I was curious as to like what you thought Christians believed, and if there was like a work-based, because I know Ray doesn't believe that, and so I was curious as to what your opinion was.
Right, so that's, you know, I can only repeat the basic of the theology. So, yeah.
So Ray, what do you have to say about her doubts as a Christian? Is that, is that good and normal, or is it because you're in Christ?
No, I think it's a perfectly appropriate question. Christ himself said, by their fruits you shall know them. And in Galatians, it kind of specifies, and the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, self-control. And I don't know any non-Christians who would be opposed to any of those virtues. But I think there's a growing conviction, not only on your own part, but on the part of others who would see that in you and saying, yes, that's verifying that this person has a genuine faith.
One thing becoming more Christ-like. In relation to this question of the Bible verse, 1 John 5, 12 and 13, I think, it says, I write these things to you who believe in the name of the Son of God so that you may know that you have eternal life. So some Christians may say that if you believe in Jesus, you shouldn't be doubting whether you have eternal life. You should have a security. So the doubt, you don't really need to doubt if you're really a believer.
I don't see doubt itself as anything adversarial either. Rather, we're to do something about that doubt by pursuing truth. this guy that I mentioned, University of Washington Med School, researcher said something I thought was very fascinating. He said, unspoken doubts are like spoiled children. If you ignore them, they'll hit you. So I think we need to do something about our doubts.
You might hate my question. On the topic of hope, when you guys were giving your opening statements, it seemed to me that the two of you were talking about completely different timelines of the topic. Like, Sylvia, you were talking more about the past and the present and the here and now, what are the content of our hope was. But for Ray, I heard you talking more about the future and eternity and what the content of our hope is in that sense.
Yeah.
So it was hard for me to sort of look at them side by side. So I'm just wondering if each of you could briefly talk about the other side of the coin. So for Sylvia, what do you see as the content of our hope for the future, like way down the line in eternity? And Ray, what do you think is the content of our hope for the here and now, and for our immediate posterity, what is the hope?
Great question.
Yeah.
Well, the reason I didn't get there is because I lost track of time. Now, I'm not going to talk about eternity. I don't know that we know enough to know that eternity is something that doesn't make any sense to me, basically. When I spoke about progress, technology, I'm talking about multi-generational progress. I'm casting my mind 10,000 years into the future, 20,000 years. If our species is still around, it might be a different species, as has been mentioned, whether by direct gene manipulation or, you know, it's a vish. Evolution works on longer time scales than that. But they will be my descendants and your descendants. And I am concerned about their well-being. I will be gone, but that doesn't reduce my investment in the future. And, you know, I see a future where hopefully human beings will colonize other planets in our solar system. Maybe in multi-generational ships move to other solar systems, increase knowledge. That in and of itself is such an inspiring mission for me, for humanity. I really think of what, not what can I, you know, I want to pay off my mortgage without having a disability that requires me to go into bankruptcy because I can't work anymore. I hope that my son will survive longer than I will. I hope that he'll be happy. These are the small hopes that I have for my life. But, you know, I have hopes for humanity as well. And those are the ones that I'm using, I'm trying to use my life to further and to fulfill. And that gives me a huge purpose.
Great question, Elizabeth. Thanks. I focused on the future because every story will have some kind of resolution, a denouement, what's going to happen in the future. And I think we've been afforded that kind of a glimpse in the Bible. And that has everything to do with how we live in the here and now. So those parts of the Bible that do address the future don't do so as an end in itself, but actually say, and here's how we should live in the here and now because of that. And so I see tremendous ethical responsibilities to begin to enact what that future is going to look like in the here and now.
Okay, we have one more question, and you guys can close with a 1 or 2 minute summary.
This is Sylvia, in regard to hope, that was a good question that she had, you know, in the future. Science shows us every day on the news that, you know, the ozone is deteriorating, that our sun is dying, global warming is melting, the polar ice caps going to affect the oceans, that manufacturing is killing our streams and our rivers and even the ocean sides that border our countries, and our farmland, the soil is being deteriorating by all the chemicals that we put in it. Science tells us that our Earth is dying at a more rapid rate these days than it's ever been. How do you have hope?
I'm not sure that I agree that that's what science is telling us. First of all, let's notice that science...
You don't agree with science?
No. I don't think that science is saying that. I think science isn't agreeing with you. But to be sure, I know only about some of those items. I am not so fully informed about all of the things you brought up that I can say with certainty. We have a problem with species extinction. We have a problem with global warming. But the ozone thing, we took action. We fixed it.
The ozone's fixed?
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. And you know, and what happened is science said, wait a second, we have a problem. And we took action. By the way, despite resistance, you know, we have Margaret Thatcher, who's a conservative, and they're not usually big on regulation, but Margaret Thatcher was also a chemist. She got the problem. This is the power of understanding what's going on. She disagreed with her buddy Ron over here in America. She understood the problem, and she was a driving force behind fixing this problem. So we have identified the problems. There are pathways forward. The European countries have met the Kyoto agreements. The United States hasn't even signed it yet. When you recognize a problem, you can take action. I am not enough of an expert to tell you in detail what actions need to be taken in each of those instances, but we have solutions to these problems, and if we don't have them yet, we can find them out. Human beings are amazingly ingenious. When a gun is held to our head, we come up with solutions. And, you know, right now, a lot of people are denying that the gun is being held to our head, and that worries me a great deal.
Ray, do you have a comment on that question?
Nope.
Okay, so then we're going to summarize. Can you take 1 or 2 minutes? We'll start with Ray this time because Sylvia opened up, so I think we'll start to summarize with Ray.
Okay.
So just 1 or 2 minutes.
I suppose my chief comment would be that for the smiley-faced atheists, I can genuinely say I'm glad for today when you have the smiley face, but I fear for you tomorrow as life continues, as personal tragedies are encountered, as physical deterioration takes place, that you might end up going the same route as countless others who have gone before you, who end up being much more depressed at the end of life. And I just started writing a list. I could probably multiply as many, many times over, but George Bernard Shaw, Aldous Huxley, Bertrand Russell, Mark Twain, Ernest Hemingway, the list could go on and on and on and on. And what I'm saying is, I'm quite certain that for some of you who are on this track already, that it's a road that's going to lead to very dark moments in the future.
Thank you.
Okay. Well, what I have to say is that human beings have a track record of solving problems and of making things better. And I don't particularly care what the content of your beliefs is and what the content of your hopes is. Just please don't get in our way of making things better.
Okay, and with that, we'll conclude the presentation tonight. And if you have this handout here, there's also another debate coming up at Portland State University, May 13th. So if you're interested in this kind of thing, you might be interested in that. Let's give both of these people a hand.